Spirochete, Morelia, Burger Ferry. Get carried to, the bacteria gets carried to a host by a vector, and that vector is Ixodes, it's a tick. The reservoir where these bacteria live are field mice. And on the field mice, it is the larval stage that is living on that field mice. But adult ticks go feed and mate on deer, but deer are dead end hosts and they are not infected by the ticks. Symptoms, or signs I should say, is a bullseye rash. 75% of the patients that would be bit by this tick that gets Lyme's disease would have that rash. And when the rash fades, then you get flu-like symptoms. And this Lyme's disease, a lot of people that get this have trouble with it for even after, you know, they've been treated for years. Without treatment, the heart is affected. You may need a pacemaker. And you have chronic neurological symptoms. Get some cases of meningitis and encephalitis.
Is this more frequent in geographical areas?
Yes, it's more frequent in the east of the United States, eastern U.S.
Eastern?
Yeah, and it's endemic to eastern U.S.
But this is more in the forest, right?
Well, any place that ticks would be able to live, which would be areas with trees and brush, and it doesn't have to be a forest as we know it, but if there's brush and things like that, they can live on that. And any animals that it could live off of, any place that there would be rodents that it could live on. There's that bullseye rash. So you would, if you saw that, then you need to go into the doctor and be checked out. Although there's 25% of the people that don't have the rash, so it'd be hard to diagnose the disease. Typhus, that's caused by a rickettsia, which is a type of bacteria. They're very tiny bacteria, so they are obligate intracellular parasites of eukaryotic cells. They're spread by arthropod vectors. The bacteria infect the endothelial cells of the vascular system. That's the inner lining of the blood vessels. And that results in inflammation. And then the inflammation causes blockage and rupture of the small blood vessels. One of the guys I worked with went back to Vietnam and came down with typhus, so he couldn't come home until he didn't have typhus anymore. He can't afford it with it, I guess. Epidemic typhus, that one is louse-borne. So the pathogen is Rickettsia perwazikii. And that one is, that's a bacteria, and it's carried in the GI tract of the louse, Pediculus humanus corporis. So the louse is the vector, it's taking that bacteria to you. Transmission is through the louse feces, when after the louse bites you. Bacteria are in the digestive tract of the louse. And when he bites you, then he poops at the same time, and the bacteria are in the feces. And so if it gets into the bite, then it can get into your system, or you may scratch the bite and get it into your system or your eyes. It's found in crowded, unsanitary conditions where lice can move easily from one host to another. Epidemic fashion. Symptoms are prolonged fever, Cooper, a rash or small red spots caused by subcutaneous hemorrhaging. Treatment is tetracycline or chloramphenicol. And to eliminate the conditions, you know, crowded conditions and dirty areas where these lice can live. They have vaccines for the military. So that was epidemic typhus. There's also endemic murine typhus. And it occurs sporadically rather than an epidemic. Murine is Latin for mouse. So rodents such as rats and squirrels are the host for this type of typhus. The bacterial pathogen is Rickettsia typhi. And it is transmitted by the rat Xenophila teopsis. So clinically, endemic and epidemic typhus are the same, but endemic typhus is less severe than epidemic typhus. Treatment would be tetracycline or chloramphenicol, and then prevention would be rat control. Tick-borne typhus. I know you guys have heard of this one. Rocky Mountain spotted fever. Mm-hmm. Heard of it? No. Pathogen is bacteria is Rickettsia. And it is a parasite of ticks. And 1 week after the tick bite, you get a macular rash develops, and it can be mistaken for measles, except that rash can be on the palms of the hands and the soles of the feet. And because it's bacterial. But if you have a viral caused rash, those usually are not on the palms of the hands or the soles of the feet. Diagnosis is by fluorescent antibody test and PCR. Prevention is to avoid ticks. So if you go out hiking, you have to wear appropriate clothes and keep your bare legs and things covered and arms when you're out hiking in tick country. And I went hiking with my daughter. She lives in North Carolina. And then she does a tick check when you come back. Your clothes and you are checked for ticks. I'm glad we don't have ticks. I don't want to be checking for ticks all the time. Treatment is tetracycline and chloramphenicol. There's no vaccine. Without treatment, there's a 20% mortality rate. And it's most common in the east and southeast U.S. So that if you've never seen a tick, there's a tick. And when they eat, you know, they can be small, and then when they eat, they swell up. And they used to, these are wives' tales, they used to say to put a burnt match on it, because they get a burrow under your skin. And if you pull it off, you could leave part of the tick inside you. So. But I think a better way is to put Vaseline or something on you. So this is the rash from Rocky Mountain spotted fever. So it looks like a measles rash, except for it's also on the palms of the hand. Viral hemorrhagic fevers. So These fevers are certain viral fevers that are accompanied by severe hemorrhagic lesions of the tissues. Most of them are zoonotic. It can be classic or emerging. Classic means that they've been around for a long time, and emerging means they're fairly new, or they could be changing somehow. One type of viral hemorrhagic fever, which is classic, is yellow fever. It's been around for quite a while. It's caused by an arbovirus, arbo meaning arthropod-borne virus, and it is transmitted by the bite of the mosquito Aedes aegypti. Early symptoms are fever, chills, headaches, and you can develop nausea and vomiting as well. Later symptoms are jaundice. That means where your skin turns yellow, or mainly you can see it in your eyes turning yellow, the whites of your eyes. And that means that there's liver damage and you're getting these deposits of bile pigments in the skin. And if you travel, I went to South America, and one of the shots you have to get when you go down there is a yellow fever vaccine. Yellow fever is endemic to Africa and Central and South America. Monkeys are the natural reservoir, but human to human transmission as well. There's no specific treatment, and the mortality rate is about 20%. Vaccine is live attenuated virus. And we don't have it here in the United States because we have really good mosquito abatement programs, but I heard that there are some mosquitoes in Orange County that are of the type that can carry this virus. So I wasn't pleased to hear that. There's a picture of a guy that has, you can see the whites of his eyes are yellow because he has jaundice. And he has that yellow tinge to his skin as well. Also a classic viral hemorrhagic fever is dengue fever. They also call it breakbone fever. It's a milder disease than yellow fever, and it's rarely fatal. They call it breakbone fever because it's quite painful and feels like your bones are breaking. It is an RNA virus that causes it, and it's also transmitted by Aedes aegypti. It's endemic to the Caribbean and tropical areas, and there are 100 million cases a year worldwide. So that's a lot. In the U.S., we have more than 100 cases, and they're usually imported from someplace. Symptoms are fever, severe muscle and joint pain, and rash. Diagnosis are by clinical signs, rise in the IgM titers, and isolation of the virus from blood. Prevention is a live attenuated vaccine that is being tested, and eliminates the mosquito. And there is no treatment.
So you have it forever?
No, I don't myself.
You just go the way it's on?
I think so. Or you could be one of the dengue hemorrhagic fever is a serious